Very good afternoon to all of you. We are here to have the dialogue, the Roundtable on Energy and Climate, African Leaders Roundtable on Energy and Climate. My name is Daniel Makuhera. I will be your moderator for this session. And the discussion we are having here is about talking about what responses African leaders can do as far as issues of energy and climate change are concerned. And we have His Excellency Idriss Déby, the President of Chad. He's here. Round of applause for him. His Excellency, the Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, His Excellency Osi Jabo. Round of applause for him. The Honorable Prime Minister of Mozambique, Carlos Agostinho do Rosario, a round of applause for him also. And is the Honorable Carl Hermann Gustav Schlettwein, who is the Finance Minister of Namibia, sitting in for His Excellency, the President of Namibia, Hage Geingob, a round of applause for him also. And of course, the host of the president of the host country of these annual meetings of the African Development Bank, His Excellency Edgar Lungu of the Republic of Zambia. The house rules that we are going to have is we'll interact with the leaders here on the podium, and then we will, time permitting, we are running behind schedule, we will also get to go to the floor and get a little bit of questions if that's all, if that's okay, Your Excellencies. And
the Minister of Finance, who is sitting in the podium, is in there. Is he not supposed to be here?
He's, you call him. I'll call you now. I'll let you know. Okay, we are inviting the Finance Minister, I think, of Namibia. I'm told that he's not on the podium, but he should be coming here. Now, the issues for the discussion, the debate will focus around how Africa can contribute to prevent global catastrophic climate changes while building the energy systems needed to sustain growth, create jobs, and lift millions of people out of poverty in the continent, and we'll get to have the specific questions. And maybe I want to start with you, President Lungu, since we are here at your shores, and say we hear already that there are challenges here. There's already load shedding that's happening. Kariba is drying up, and many people you talk to, be it the taxi driver or the people in the streets, they seem to be now au fait with the term climate change. What are the responses as far as the government is concerned?
Yeah, thank you. Let me once again welcome everyone to Zambia and the 2016 annual meetings of the African Development Bank Group. As I indicated earlier during the official opening session, energy and climate issues are topical and very critical for many of our countries in Africa today, and thus the conference is coming at the most appropriate time. It is without dispute that if we do not take the much-needed reforms and measures to counter the energy deficit, we erode the economic and social gains made in most of our countries over the last few years. These measures, at the minimum, should include broadening the energy mix. That is, putting in place also smart ways of addressing the effects of climate change. Let me just quickly address some of the issues that, in my opinion, are important to policymakers regarding the challenges being faced related to energy shortages and climate change. I'll commence by giving a few comments on energy. It is widely agreed that energy is a catalyst, an enabler of economic progress and development, and the need for universal access to reliable and affordable energy by all citizens on the continent and the corporates is not therefore debatable. Energy transcends all sectors. It is vital in education, in health, industry, and indeed all spheres of our very existence. However, in addressing the energy gap, it has its own imperatives, and that need balancing. Firstly, we always remain mindful of the environmental concerns that obligates us to be responsible for posterity. And that's why each time we want to set up a project, it's subject of controversy. The issues of clean energy come into play, and the issue, like I've said, of forest deforestation and just eroding our environment come into play. So closely tied to this is the second phase of access. Whilst the consideration for clean energy remains important, one should not forget that Africa's problem is not that of switching from carbon-oriented to clean energy, but that of access to power. According to the 2015 World Energy Outlook of the International Energy Agency, about 1.2 billion people, which represents about 17% of the global population, do not have access to electricity. At least they don't have access to electricity in 2013. The report further shows that more than 95% of those were in sub-Saharan Africa and developing Asia, and they were predominantly in rural areas. So rural area connectivity in Zambia currently is one of the things we want to achieve. It stands at 4.5%, and this is an accepted low. It's very, very low for us, and we think we can do better, and we should do better. This, again, raises policy issues. Should our priorities be on increasing access to energy, using whatever resources we have, such as coal, which is more available and cheaper? Or should we concentrate our efforts on deepening reliance on clean energy, such as solar, which is very expensive, as you very well know? So it's a dilemma. I'm aware that many cooperating partners and development institutions are now refusing to finance energy sources deemed unclean, but at the expense of those that have never had the opportunity. So we have to resolve these issues. Further, lack of access to energy itself is a counterproductive move to the environment, as the majority of our populations have to rely on sources such as wood, which leads to climate challenge again, which I will refer to. Zambia is the consumption of charcoal, wood, and the mixed biomass accounts for 70% of the total energy consumption. And this does not help us much. Again, when you look at the balance, which is the hydro, what with the water levels diminishing in the dams, and we can only find solutions through gatherings like this. The third issue is how to achieve a good mix in the sources of energy, which will help us survive climate change at the same time, keep the environment going. We have the problem of lack of diversification in the energy sector, and we need to look into this seriously. Currently, for example, in Zambia, 99% of our energy power is hydro, and for 2 years there has been no rainfall. This has caused serious shortages of electricity, and like I said earlier on, it might take 3 years, assuming there will be rains, for us to have generation capacity. We are producing at 1,000 megawatts, but the capacity we have is 2,425 megawatts. So if rains don't fall, we're in trouble. But should we wait until rains come, we need a solution.
Some people would say you probably are in trouble already, Mr. President.
And
I hear what you're saying. Yeah. What I would do, if it's okay, I would ask you to just pause there so that I go through your other colleagues also and get to hear maybe what are the situations in the country, and then we can have a dialogue. I know you're behind the scenes bosses have prepared speeches for you, but what I would want us to really do is probably to interact and have a discussion that is very helpful and see how countries can probably work together. Situation, Mr. President, President Dabi, in your country, where are you? We've heard what Zambia is talking about. Where are you in this situation? Are you okay? Do we need to work together? Do we need to join hands? Is climate change also affecting your country?
Bien, merci, Monsieur le Président vient de me précéder. Hein? Je crois que la question de l'énergie est une question qui touche tous les pays africains. Il n'y a pas un seul pays africain qui a atteint son autosuffisance énergétique ou son indépendance énergétique ou même voir sa souveraineté énergétique. Mais il faut d'abord connaître les problèmes qui se posent à ce continent. Les problèmes qui se posent sont nombreux. Il faut d'abord identifier les problèmes et après voir quelles sont les solutions que nous pourrons envisager ensemble dans ce débat, puisque nous voulons aider la BAD, en fait, disons, la gouvernance de la BAD, pour mieux aborder la question de l'énergie. Le premier point qui me semble très important, qu'il faut affirmer, c'est que 2/3 des populations africaines n'ont pas accès à l'énergie, n'ont pas accès à l'électricité, 2/3 des populations africaines. Le deuxième point important, la gouvernance, la faiblesse de gouvernance et de planification dans le secteur. Beaucoup de pays répondent au gré des urgences, mais pas au gré de leur potentialité ou au gré de la demande. Les faiblesses institutionnelles réglementaires qui ne permettent pas une implication suffisante du secteur privé. Là aussi, c'est un problème. Si le secteur privé ne s'implique pas, qui doit être financé par les pays, les pays africains n'ont pas de ressources. De la même manière que le secteur privé africain est aussi limité. Donc, il y a là un problème. Les besoins en financement non comblés en volume et en type de financement. Faible performance technique, financière et commerciale des sociétés nationales d'électricité. La non prise en compte de l'approche régionale pour développer les projets intégrateurs, notamment les énergies renouvelables. Maintenant, quels sont nos potentiels en Afrique en termes d'énergie? Les potentiels en Afrique sont énormes. Nous avons l'énergie solaire, éolienne, hydroélectrique et voire même nucléaire, puisque l'Afrique est un des continents producteur de l'uranium et exportateur de l'uranium ailleurs, là où on utilise. Donc, si je prends l'exemple du Tchad, il y a le taux le plus élevé au monde, le taux d'ensoleillement le plus important au monde. Mais jusqu'à aujourd'hui, sur ce secteur de l'énergie propre et qui est possible de mettre à la disposition si nous avions des ressources, nous n'avons pas pu, jusqu'à jour aujourd'hui, avoir même pas 10 mégawatts en fait en énergie solaire. Alors que l'ensoleillement du Tchad, en fait, disons, c'est 360 jours. Donc, C'est un secteur porteur, mais qui n'est pas exploité, par exemple. Regardons un peu de près le reste du continent. Nous regardons la RDC, le barrage de Inga. Ce barrage de Inga peut donner de l'énergie à toute l'Afrique. Qu'attendons-nous ça? Le problème qui se pose, c'est un problème de financement, en fait, disons. Ce n'est ni autre. Le seul barrage d'Inga peut suffire tout le continent. Donc, il s'agit d'aller exploiter. Là aussi, c'est une possibilité, puisque la capacité de ces barrages est moins égale à la moitié de la puissance nécessaire. Je dis bien de la puissance nécessaire pour résoudre le problème d'accès pour toute l'Afrique. 50%, c'est-à-dire que rien que par le barrage d'Inga. Actions possibles, les actions qui sont possibles de les faire. La promotion de l'énergie solaire à une très large échelle devrait permettre à l'Afrique d'avoir un accès à un coût moindre et de bénéficier de l'utilisation de cette énergie renouvelable. C'est pourquoi il faut encourager le développement en Afrique de l'industrie solaire avec une approche régionale. De deux, que les institutions financières de développement comme la BAD puissent augmenter sensiblement leur financement et qu'ils renforcent leur assistance en termes de conseils aux pays. Elles doivent aussi être plus flexibles, car souvent elles sont lourdes dans les décisions, lourdes dans les prises de décisions. Trois, le gouvernement africain, face aux ressources publiques limitées, devrait assurer une plus grande participation du secteur privé, notamment africain, dans le secteur de l'énergie. Car personne ne viendra d'ailleurs développer pour nous ce secteur stratégique. 4. Pour l'Afrique, développer l'accès à l'énergie qui soit compatible avec l'environnement n'est pas un grand défi. Car nous avons en Afrique un grand potentiel en énergie renouvelable qui doit profiter abondamment des baisses des coûts des technologies qui s'observent. Protéger l'environnement en faisant la promotion de nouvelles sources d'énergie facile d'utilisation pour remplacer l'utilisation du bois domestique, ce qui nous amène à protéger nos forêts et notre environnement aussi. Avoir une grande approche régionale des solutions. Par exemple, pour la réalisation du barrage hydroélectrique d'Enga en RDC, pourquoi ne pas faire en sorte que tous les pays africains, sous l'égide financière de la Banque africaine de développement et sous l'égide technique des différentes pôles énergétiques régionaux, s'approprient ce projet qui peut, grâce aux interconnexions, servir tous les continents. Nous devons rendre cela une réalité. Donc, comme je disais tantôt, il y a les défis, il y a les potentialités et il y a des actions possibles. Si nous agissons dans les trois domaines en ordre, nous cherchons les défis ensemble et les possibilités du continent. En troisième, ce sont les actions possibles qui déboucheront à la réalisation des projets réalistes qui nous permettront donc d'éclairer l'Afrique. Merci.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. But when I listen to you, I hear you lamenting why these things are not happening, but I'm glad this is why this panel is here. We have the leadership that then talks about this. At times, there's probably a thinking from the masses of the continent that the leadership doesn't think that there's a way of solving it. I suppose the question is, why are we still talking about it? And that's what I would want Vice President Osin Jabo to also come in and say, we have been to conferences, Vice President, and we talk about this over and over and over again. The president there has also just outlined on issues that we know of. You know, it's not a new thing, but from where you sit, I know, I don't know whether I can still say it's still early days. I think you have to hit the ground running in these things of governance of countries. From where you are seated, how do you plan to solve this issue? I know it's an issue in the country. Collectively, or bilaterally, or as a country?
Well, thank you. I think for us, we simply have to harness all that's available. As you know, we are one of the major hydrocarbon-rich countries. So for us, fossil fuel is important, and we have to leverage all that we can get in fossil fuel. Coal is also important, you know, and of course you're familiar with all of the controversies around renewable energy and all that. We also have, you know, capacity, of course, for solar power and other renewable energy sources. But we're dealing with a major problem.
So Vice President, if I may come in, you're saying energy now and then environment later.
Let me just say that it is possible to work both together, but for us, priority today is development. And we have to take development seriously because we have a population. I mean, if you look at it, even in Africa, I mean, the 45% of those who do not have power are in Africa. Of that number, you know, we take about half, almost half. So it's a serious issue for us, and we think that renewable energy and all of the concerns about climate change are important, but we must prioritize development. We must prioritize development. And we think that it's possible to work both together. And that's why we think that if you look at some of the developments around fossil fuel, we think that we must use our fossil fuel to the maximum. We must use our coal to the maximum. And we'll simply call on the support of the developed nations that are aggressive about reducing GHG in especially coal-fired plants to give us the technology that is required. You know, because obviously there's available technology to make clean to make coal cleaner. And we'll simply call upon them to give us that technology. The truth of the matter is that, as you know, I mean, Africa is, you know, I mean, is the least contributor to GHG emissions. And we're the hardest hit by all of the consequences of climate change. That's the paradox. But that paradox becomes jeopardy where we are being asked to take the greater burden of resolving the problems of climate change. So we really need the help of the West in particular.
We need the help of the West, but I'm sure I would want to come back to you and say, but what are we doing as African countries? What do we need to do? I'll let you answer that later. Yeah. I just want to go through the whole panel, and then we can come back and delve deeper into some of these questions. Prime Minister, some would say then maybe you're in a fortunate situation. Gas is, you're discovering it all over, and maybe this might help with your energy requirements. Would I be correct to say that?
Yeah, thank you so much for your question. But first of all, let me respond in Portuguese.
It's fine, sir.
Primeiro, eu queria manifestar a nossa alegria de estar aqui no painel. Em nome do Presidente da República, que não pôde estar, por razões internas no país, e dizermos que antes de dar a sua resposta, dizer que esta matéria de energia é uma matéria muito complexa, muito difícil, e que então requer intervenções concertadas, intervenções muito fortes de todo o continente. O acesso à energia à população, e o acesso à energia para beneficiar a agricultura e a industrialização são desafios que não se podem ser vencidos por um só país. Esta é a primeira questão que nós queremos colocar. A segunda questão, dentro dessa concertação, dessa atuação concertada na região, pensamos que nós podemos atuar em quatro ou cinco coisas. A primeira, atuarmos juntos para atrairmos investimentos e financiamentos. Depois, atuarmos juntos para podermos, na área comercial, e nos aspectos de regulatórios, não é? De legais. Temos também matérias para juntos trabalharmos. Também podemos trabalhar juntos na concertação de políticas estratégicas. E eu vou desenvolver um pouco estas áreas. Em relação à atração de investimentos, pensamos que esta abordagem global e regional é boa porque todo investimento requer financiamentos. E o financiamento requer viabilidade dos projetos. E quando atuamos concertados em conjunto, a viabilidade dos projetos fica mais fácil. Fica mais fácil e é uma componente de boa atuar. Também pensamos que no domínio comercial podemos trabalhar juntos. Primeiro, podemos trabalhar usando as nossas empresas de eletricidade para poderem promover, dinamizar o comércio da região, para que os que têm recursos possam partilhar com os outros também da região. A outra componente é a componente tarifária. E aqui temos que trabalhar juntos para que a tarifa seja muito equilibrada, de forma que a tarifa traga uma situação de win-win situation, para que, na verdade, todos os que geram energia, os que transportam energia, os que utilizam energia, todos ficam a ganhar. Uma tarifa muito equilibrada que não deixe espaço para que não haja win-win. Na parte legal, podemos, sim, senhor, trabalhamos juntos, como disse o presidente da Zâmbia, para termos uma legislação comum que promova parcerias público-privadas. Nós, em Moçambique, por exemplo, temos uma lei de 2011 que promove essas parcerias e pensamos que há espaço aqui para podermos trabalhar juntos. Indo para a sua questão, Moçambique, de facto, tem um potencial. Temos 117 gigawatts de gás, temos 56 gigawatts de carvão, temos 18 gigawatts de hidrelétrica. E a nossa abordagem devia ser uma abordagem de diversificação dessa matriz. E neste momento, como disse o presidente da Zâmbia e os outros presidentes, a fonte hidrelétrica está com dificuldades de impactos ambientais. Está cada vez mais difícil por causa dos impactos ambientais. A fonte do gás é uma fonte que pode, sim, gerar muitos recursos, mas que levam muito tempo. A experiência de Moçambique é de que investimentos no gás são de médio prazo e exigem muito esforço inicial. Então, pensamos nós aqui que todos juntos podemos trabalhar para que possamos aproveitar um recurso que já está disponível. E esse recurso chama-se carvão. E então, podemos trabalhar de forma que tragamos tecnologias apropriadas para fazermos uso de um recurso endógeno que já existe nos nossos países. Essa é uma área que nós todos temos que olhar com uma rapidez, como disse o presidente, o vice-presidente da Nigéria. Portanto, nós acreditamos, sim, num trabalho conjunto para desenvolvermos as infraestruturas de geração, de distribuição, de transportes, e aqui, digamos, muito espaço para trabalharmos para termos a resiliência dos impactos ambientais. Ficamos felizes na abertura, a abertura do BAD, não é? Em apoiar todos esses projetos, essas 5 prioridades, e pensamos que estamos em boas condições de transformarmos a África, para que a África não tenha pobreza. Quem tem luz, tem desenvolvimento. Quem não tem luz, não tem desenvolvimento. E a abertura do BAD, pensamos que é um espaço muito importante para que todos os países possamos aproveitar. Vamos à frente. Juntos vamos ganhar e venceremos. A luta continua.
Thank you very much. Yes, a round of applause for you. I would want to follow up again, Prime Minister, later on. Together we can win all these great ideas that you have outlined. I just want to know why they haven't been implemented. But that's after I've also asked a question from Prime Minister of Tanzania, Prime Minister Majawalia. The situation in Tanzania is there's also again gas the discovery, and what I'm hearing, there seems to be a narrative here that we know what the issues are, we know why we are not powering our nations, we know why we are not lighting up our countries. In your country, where is the issue? President Davi said, it's an issue of money. Is that the issue? Because we know what we need.
Thank you. The first I want to talk about Africa in general, that energy services in Africa is a crisis. It's a big crisis because in Africa, the accessibility of electrification in general is a crisis because no country which afforded to reach to the rural areas to provide energy. And this is because the situation in Africa will require capital investment. But all of these issues, to me, I can say that we have to look on these 4 problems. One is financial. Financial is crisis to many countries in Africa. The second one is technology. Our country, they are not in position to acquire technology for energy provision. So many countries without the technology, you cannot afford to provide energy to the rural areas. The third one is expertise. If you have a technology, the technology maybe can be the old one that we need to have a modern one, but you need expertise who can run those technologies. The third one is we think it, we have to the issue of industry. Many Africans need technology expertise with these the industries so that you can provide electricity to the rural areas. With this, I think we have to solve these problems through if you have a government commitment to allow investment in the country. This would be one of the how to solve the problem, as I said before. So we need commitment or goodwill of the political will of the government to allow investors to implement energy provision to all over the country. For the case of Tanzania, as you said, in Tanzania, we have all these resources. As I said, that we have a lot of problems, financial, technology, expertise. Tanzania is one of the countries which suffers also in those areas. For instance, now Tanzania discovers a huge of natural gas, which is estimated to 57.25 standard cubic feet. We have gas, natural gas, but we are lacking technology, finance, and everything. Second one, we have another opportunity. We have a reserve of coal, which is estimated to 1.9 billion of tons. So we need technology, we need finance to utilize those coal we have in the country. We have also another opportunity. We have uranium, which is estimated of 200 pounds. All of these need technology, need finance to utilize for energy provision in our country. So, plus we have also wind speed, we have also geothermal, we have also biomass. For saying so, we come to ask for you all. The Africa continent, outside the African continent, Tanzania has decided to open the door for investors to come to Tanzania to invest. And I would like to call you also, if you are ready, to assist in those areas which we are facing, to come to Tanzania to invest so that we can provide energy services to the rural areas. And where we think now, through our natural gas we have, what we are doing now is we are revisiting our policy strategy. We are also revisiting the institutional setup. The third one, we are revisiting the legal framework, also regulatory framework, so that we can suit to allow investors to come to Tanzania and invest for the energy provision. Our intention is to provide electricity to the rural areas. This is our position we have in Tanzania.
I just want to follow up. It's really a clarion call you have made. But when you speak of political will, this is the leadership, most of it, of the continent. Are you suggesting there hasn't been political will to want to do this?
I said that the country needs political will or government commitment. On this, first should know that the people are suffering for lacking energy. And if you have energy, now you have to open up the door so that people and other companies from different countries can come and invest in your country. Political will meaning that the country should be willing to provide those services to the rural areas. For that matter, you can see that people are getting benefits from the country by the services given by the president, by the government itself. That's why I'm saying that it needs political will means you give an access to your people to acquire, to receive.
I know yours is a new yes. administration, just to follow up on that, but it's an administration that whose party has been in power for a while now. What are you practically doing right now? And I think that's the discussion we want to have here. What are you practically doing now? What are the steps that you have put in place to making sure that this energy gap is closed?
In Tanzania, what we're doing now is, first, provided we have those resources, as I said, what you are doing is that we already opened the door to invite donors, to invite investors to invest. There are a number of investors who have shown the intention of coming to Tanzania to invest. So now we are discussing every investor went to the area where he think he can invest. The second one, within the country, as I said, that we are reviving our policy, we are reviving institutional setup so that we can manage to provide electricity to the rural areas. And we have a big project of electrification, rural area of electrification, which also goes to the village level and is provide services. Now we have been reached to almost 52% of the villages we have in the country to provide electrification. Provided we have these resources, now we are in position also to raise up the percentage to provide electricity to the village level. Second one, provided we have natural gas, a huge of natural gas, we are now planning to build LNG, the industry which process the gas so that we can export outside the country. So now we are planning also to share with the other countries, neighbor countries like Kenya, Uganda, Malawi, Burundi, even Zambia. We can provide a line, and now we are building a line to Zambia through Mbeya across the Tunduma border to come to Zambia to provide electricity. We believe that in the near future we'll have a lot of electricity to supply to other countries. So we'll earn a lot of money, then we can use those money to facilitate electrification to the rural areas.
So clearly the issue of finance does come up again. A round of applause. Thank you very much for that. President Davi, I see you're raising your hand, and I didn't want to follow up on your point also you made on we have Inga, why hasn't it happened? And this is over and over a discussion that happens at the AU, a discussion that happens when we are here. When are we then going to see that? I also want to bring in the idea of the new deal for energy that the African Development Bank has started, and I want to know whether the excellencies here know about it, and I want to know, I haven't heard anyone saying we are in discussions with the AFDB, which is talking about lighting and powering Africa by 2025. But your point, sir.
Merci. Une fois de plus, pour donner la parole, je voudrais certainement être très court. Le défi énergétique est un défi continental, au niveau de tout le continent. Il n'y a que 5 ou 6 pays sur le panel. Si chacun de nous reste simplement de parler de son pays, évidemment, nous oublions l'élément important et puis la mission importante de la BAD, qui consiste à faire en sorte que dans les années à venir, par un programme bien précis, prenant en compte l'ensemble des demandes, en fait, disons, des pays, agir en conséquence et investir et donc éclairer l'Afrique. Nous savons que l'Afrique a des ressources. Il y a du gaz, il y a du pétrole, il y a, comme on appelle, des feux, il y a le soleil, il y a le vent. Donc tout ça, ce sont des possibilités qu'il faut explorer et faire en sorte que l'énergie soit propre ou l'énergie n'est pas propre. Mais d'abord, il faut avoir l'accès à l'énergie pour savoir quelle énergie est propre, quelle énergie n'est pas propre. On ne peut pas nous empêcher. Ailleurs, on utilise l'énergie, comment on appelle l'énergie. Oui, nucléaire, l'énergie aussi à base de charbon. On dit que non, en Afrique, ici, ça, c'est pas bon. Nous devrions utiliser dans un cadre global de l'Afrique, dans ces 5 régions, un programme précis par région que la BAD, avec ses partenaires, doit financer, un financement important et interconnexion entre les différentes régions. Et ces différentes régions vont se connecter avec le continent tout entier. Je crois que quand j'ai parlé tout à l'heure du barrage de Inga, il n'y a pas que le fleuve de Inga. Aujourd'hui, l'Éthiopie est en train de construire un très grand barrage avec de grandes capacités. Cette électricité qui va sortir de cette barrage va non seulement servir à l'Éthiopie, mais aussi le reste des pays, y compris jusqu'à le Tchad, le Soudan du Sud, le Soudan du Nord, le Tchad, le Somalie, ou les pays limitrophes, en fait, disons. Donc, ce sont de grandes options, ce sont de grandes imaginations qu'il faut mener de manière à ce que le problème ne soit pas cantonné au problème au niveau d'un pays, mais une solution globale pour le continent. Voilà ce que je voudrais dire. Merci.
Vice President, I see you are nodding.
Yes, I agree with what President Deby has said. And I think that what I find most attractive about the energy policy is the fact that it acknowledges that we need to develop our natural resource endowments first, you know, and ensure that we optimize those, even if they are not necessarily the cleanest sources of energy, while investing in technology and investing in cleaner sources of energy as we go forward. And I'm glad to see that the AFDB realizes that we must start from what we have. We must start from our resource endowments and optimize those resource endowments. And then, you know, they say they are prepared to fund not just those resource endowments, but other cleaner sources of energy. So I think that's an important concession to where we are as a continent. And I don't think that we have the options that the more developed nations of the world have. I think we're faced with a fairly dire situation in most of Africa. We simply don't have power, and without power, there's very little that can be done, as is obvious from all that we've heard and seen. So I think that while focusing as much as we can on renewable energy sources,
yes,
you know, we must bear in mind that for industry, for example, I mean, we find that for industry, the base load power is critical. And base load power is just so much more difficult to get it from solar power, for example. I mean, how much, look at the kind of hectareage that you need just to put solar panels in order to be able to generate the kind of power that you need to run any of the industries. So we must understand that our immediate needs require, you know, the baseload power that can move us forward quickly. And that we'll get from fossil fuel, hydropower, and coal-fired plants, quite frankly. So I think that our problem is peculiar in Africa, and I think that we must address it frontally. And we must accept what its consequences are in the short term as we deal with the climate change issues as they develop.
Okay. I would want, as I said, we would want to allow questions from the floor. You can direct the questions to the excellencies here. Please make it a pointed question. Advice is welcome, but we just want to allow a lot of, as much people as possible to ask questions. Maybe now and again, I would also want to bring the AFDB. I think there are a few issues that have been raised here that I think we need to hear the voice of the AFDB, and whether then the narrative I'm picking up here is we are going to go with what we want, regardless of what the countries of the North might say about coal and other fossil fuels. So I don't know how that juggling would happen. Just show by raising your hand on the questions you would want to ask or a contribution. Do we have, I'll start with you, Minister, here. Oh, yes. Okay, I'll start with, the President directs me that I should start with the lady. So we'll start with the lady, Minister, and then I'll come to you. We have three questions pointed to a particular person, and then we move right ahead. Thank you.
Okay. Well, I'm very conscious that I'm an Irish African.
Okay.
And I listened with great interest both at the opening session and in particular to this discussion between leaders of African countries. And I understand why you have to prioritize development. Of course, because you've got to take your people out of poverty. You've got to give them energy. But I also would just advise that you think about what you're also saying, that the continent of Africa is least responsible for the problem, but is suffering more. I know this because I served with President John Kafur as the special envoy of the Secretary General on climate change on the road to Paris, followed all the discussions, took part in all the deliberations, heard all these voices. I now have a new position. I've been asked by the Secretary General to be his special envoy with a Kenyan colleague, the ambassador to the UN of Kenya, on El Nino and climate change, because we no longer can talk about El Nino on its own. It is worse now because of climate change, and this is all affecting your capacities. But I want you to bear in mind seriously that Africa is the continent that will continue to be more affected as the emission, that the global warming rises. As we get closer to 1.5, and if we go above 1.5, it will be worse in Africa. So you have to be concerned about that. And I think you have a collective voice to change the narrative on what you also need, and you've been saying. You need climate finance. You need technology. You need expertise. And we haven't been able to make the point that this is now a shared concern. Climate finance is no longer about aid to developing countries. It's about the means by which we secure the world future for all of our children. And we need to get that narrative across to the more developed parts of the world, that it's in their self-interest. Because if Africa goes into coal in particular, and it goes into more and more fossil fuel, and the least one is the gas, because it can be a bridging, and I acknowledge that it's probably the best one, is to explore your gas potential as a bridging finance. But if you go into the others, and if China does the same, and India does the same, then the future will be very catastrophic, and catastrophic sooner in African countries. So please don't think that you can do completely special pleading for your development. Yes, you must prioritize your development, but you must also persuade the world to be with you on more climate finance, transfer of technology, and that is absolutely urgent because we have committed to stay at 1.5 or well below 2 degrees, and that's the right thing for this continent so that it won't be so badly affected. I mean, look at Ethiopia. Ethiopia has done everything very well on climate, has very good climate policies, has been putting these in place over years, and now, because of El Nino, is feeling utterly devastated and has a huge number of people who are who are undernourished now and may face famine. Imagine. And that is the future unless we get over this problem of emissions. So I plead with African leaders, use your collective voice to insist that you get more support. And certainly I will be with you all the way on that, absolutely. And I know you need to develop. Thank you.
But I just wanted to do a follow-up question to the Irish African and say, what would you say to African leaders who say, well, we promised 100 billion that by 2020 it should come, But that 100 billion has only comes in 2020, and also it's not legally binding.
Yeah. I would say that 100 billion is far too little, and we have to start making it the trigger for trillions of investment, particularly in Africa. And we need the private sector, as has already been mentioned. And the most important thing, and you can help to do this, is to change the mindset of the other leaders who have industrialized their economies through fossil fuel and are now starting to reduce. You have a much more difficult challenge. You have to try and navigate how to develop with the least emissions, because you're more affected if those emissions rise. And therefore, we've got to get across, it's not just 100 billion a year. It's actually that solidarity that climate finance and technology to developing countries is the means to a safe world for all of us. We're completely interconnected. The United States is already suffering more drought in California, for example, and Sandy and Katrina, etc. Know that they will suffer more, but it will be after Africa has been even more devastated. So, I think the collective voice of African leaders being much stronger on this would help a lot to change the approach to being a solidarity of climate finance where the development is needed. And that's in developing countries. That's in Africa.
A question from the Namibian finance minister, Minister Schletveen.
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator, Your Excellencies. Let me first of all voice my appreciation to share this forum and offer my apologies for President Hage Geingob not joining you. He wanted very much to be here, realizing that the topic is crucial. But as Your Excellency know, your schedules are very busy, and he was prevented by that. I'm happy to be here. And Commissioner Moderator, my take, while agreeing with what has been said about the crucial availability of energy in a sustainable, affordable, and reliable manner to develop, there's one aspect that we ministers of finance must look at, and that is, up to now, it looks as if financing the development program that we are envisaging is too expensive. We also live in an area where we cannot anymore rely on donors. We have been told that the area of aid has come to an end. And I think the important discussion that must unfold is how do we beef up own resources that enables us to fund that crucial development of the power and energy sector, as I said, in a sustainable way, environmentally sustainable, but also cost-wise sustainable. Honorable Chair, price therefore matters. Price of capital, price of financing, but also price of the power itself. If Africa wants to become industrialized, we must remain competitive. And if I take Namibia as an example, that is an uphill battle. Because of expensive financing, because of expensive technologies that have to be brought in, because of expensive expertise that we have to buy, our cost per unit power delivered to our consumers is about a third more than in the Southern African region. Now that means it is difficult to say it's affordable for households, nor is it competitive, allowing us to develop our industries. So I think, therefore, the debate on how we become more affordable and more sustainable in terms of financing and costs is a crucial one. I think the first step is to get better deals for our natural resources. I am convinced that the contracts that we sign with people that are granted access to our resources are 10-to-1 bad contracts. We have to improve these contracts and get a better deal. Secondly, I think the old structures of state monopolies for power generation and distribution may not be the optimal managerial tool or structure to forward a development agenda of this importance. Thirdly, over and above getting better deals for our natural resources, we have to work better with the international community to stop illicit flows out of Africa. Illicit flows out of Africa, financial flows that is, are far higher than donor aid was ever. And I think those two sources alone, better access to our resources and better returns on these rental agreements, plus a much tightened up tax system, harmonized tax system, stopping of illicit flows, will give Africa the necessary means to actually fund its own agenda. Mm-hmm. That is our point. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think could we get a mic behind there? And then I'll come to you, sir.
Thank you, moderator. My name is Edwin Zulu from Zambia. I'd like to answer correctly the question you have given. How can Africa contribute to solve the climate change and energy problem? First of all, I'd like to understand, the challenge here is messaging. We are giving wrong messages among ourselves. First of all, climate change affects, like we have been told in Zambia, the rain pattern, and that affects, for example, our solar. And you discover in Zambia again, we are wrongly misguiding ourselves. We are saying diversifying from hydro to solar. No, within the hydro, we have a lot of potential in mean hydro. And a bigger part of our country has a lot of water. It's not affected like the other side. So please, can we give the rightful message? Now, having said that, Zambia, for example, has potential in mean hydros, geothermal, solar, wind, waste to energy, and of course, as we are addressing issues of climate change, we cannot forget about serious afforestation issues. So that's very, very important. But also, you see most of our cities, like in Lusaka and others, are faced with issues of solid waste management challenges, which also provides another opportunity in the area of waste to energy. I feel so sad because I've been involved in this area dating back to 2004 when we met in the great city of Maputo under the World Bank Carbon Finance and Clean Development Mechanism. Now, what I would like to challenge my leaders in front there, including my own president, is that energy, climate change, it's a challenge that provides opportunities in the area of clean and green technology and businesses. So from today, let's stop looking at it as a problem. It's actually a challenge that provides a lot of opportunities. My challenge, I would like through the president to say, the colleagues who are sitting in the office in the Ministry of Lands in charge of natural resource management, they need to be woken up because the director in charge of that office is supposed to be the DNA in charge of promoting these technologies I'm talking about. I was a private sector representative 12 years ago, and here we are. We are reactional. Let's be proactive. I would like to thank the ADB president, and I will soon be putting up some few proposals to you as a response to fast track what you've said. Thank you so much.
I will be very brief, but I have a suggestion, an invitation, and a question. My suggestion to you is to think about these resources that we've heard so much about today. Think about the human resources as the resources of your country, not just the natural resources. Because if we think about it this way, we would recall that 85% of the Africans who are living in the darkness right now are living in rural communities where it will take decades to bring the grids to these areas. The average length of time that it takes for a World Bank energy project to reach completion is 9 years. That's 2025. So if we don't have these projects in place now, the deadline for the New Deal will be passed without having reached it. And this is something that none of us want. So my invitation is to work with me and the decentralized renewable energy industry to bring off-grid energy, small solar, small microhydro, which can be delivered today to these rural communities while they wait for the grid, which we know is necessary. But in the middle, in the interim, we cannot use a grid or nothing approach that leaves people in the dark. And so my question to you at the end of the day is, what is it that you are doing in your countries to promote this off-grid renewable energy, which is cheaper per connection than the grid, which is available today, and which can really solve many of the energy access problems much quicker than the grid can? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I see President Dabi, you want to respond to that, or are you generally responding? I'll let you respond, sir.
Non, je crois que c'est... Je suis parfaitement d'accord avec le Zambien qui a parlé de... dans son intervention de l'énergie propre, l'énergie verte. La question des ressources humaines qui vient d'être soulevée, c'est une question essentielle. Parce que dans ma première intervention, j'avais souligné l'importance, en fait, disons, de la question des compétences, en fait, disons, pas seulement dans la maîtrise, je dirais, de la technologie, dans la gestion comme dans la commercialisation. Je pense que c'est un ensemble tout qui est important. Maintenant, concernant la question précise, bon, vous serez les bienvenus. Je pense que vous serez un bon, qu'on appelle, contributeur, pas seulement des idées, mais vous nous donnez donc une opportunité, puisque vous pouvez travailler en étroite collaboration avec la BAD, de manière à faire des réflexions approfondies sur l'ensemble de la question, qui est une question énergie propre. On est d'accord. On est d'accord pour dire l'énergie propre. Bon, les questions climatiques, c'est vrai que nous avons les conséquences, c'est l'Afrique qui subit. Mais l'Afrique n'y est pour rien, en fait, disons, de la dégradation du climat. Au moment où, en son temps, les pays industrialisés de l'Europe et les autres s'industrialisaient, ils n'avaient pas réfléchi qu'à un certain moment donné, le climat va être affecté. Bon, ils sont arrivés à un niveau de développement où aujourd'hui, ils ne parlent plus, vous ne parlez plus de l'énergie, vous avez l'énergie que vous voulez, l'énergie éolienne, l'énergie fossile, l'énergie... solaire et puis l'énergie nucléaire aussi. Donc, quel que soit le prétexte qu'on peut prendre pour vouloir limiter, en fait, disons, à l'Afrique d'utiliser ses potentialités, n'est pas une bonne solution. Nous sommes au départ. C'est-à-dire que 2/3 de la population africaine n'a pas accès à l'énergie. Donc, vous ne pouvez pas nous faire assumer la responsabilité qui n'est pas la nôtre. On ne vous commande pas, c'est des amis, si le climat au niveau planétaire est touché, nous sommes tous touchés. Maintenant, il s'agit de mettre la main dans la poche, sans calcul, n'est-ce pas, et sans retard. Si vous voulez donner à l'Afrique une chance de se développer, ou si on veut donner une chance à l'Afrique de s'industrialiser. Nous avons entendu certains dirigeants dire que jamais l'Afrique ne va s'industrialiser et l'Afrique va consommer nos matières premières que nous allons produire. Donc on ne va pas laisser l'Afrique s'industrialiser. Il y a des idées, il y a des comportements. Il faut qu'on sorte de ce comportement et on réagisse très franchement, n'est-ce pas, pour sortir le continent de cette situation-là. Autrement dit, des réunions sur réunions, des rencontres sur rencontres, on parle beaucoup du climat, on parle beaucoup de ce qui est négatif,
L'Afrique est affectée, il faut donner de l'argent. Mais où est cet argent? On n'a jamais vu la couleur. On n'a jamais vu la couleur de cet argent-là. Donc, le moment est propice pour qu'on mette la main dans la poche, qu'on mette les moyens à la disposition du continent. Ces moyens vont être utilisés par les compétences extérieures et intérieures de l'Afrique de manière à éclairer l'Afrique. S'il y a des réticences, comme disait tantôt le ministre des Finances de Namibie, je crois ça, hein, le ministre des Finances de la Namibie, je crois, comme disait, l'Afrique doit compter sur ses propres ressources, n'est-ce pas? Si tel est le cas, puisqu'il n'y a pas aujourd'hui, dans aucun de nos pays, il n'y a coopération bilatérale, aide budgétaire, tout ça c'est terminé, ça n'existe plus. Ça n'existe plus. Donc, on est en train de faire du débrouillardisme nous-mêmes, par nos propres ressources. Nous essayons de colmater. Maintenant, on dit que les Africains doivent se mettre ensemble. Le continent doit agir ensemble dans une seule direction pour éclairer le continent. Et nous allons utiliser l'ensemble des ressources qui sont à notre disposition. Il faut nous aider financièrement, sans calcul, sans retard et sans pression, ou bien sans conditionnalité. Si tel n'est pas le cas, dans 20 ans, nous serons encore sur place en train de parler de la même question de l'énergie. Merci.
Yes, we continue with more questions. Madame from Tanzania, and then I'll come to you. Oh, there's also, two questions from here, and to you, sir. And then I'll come to you.
Thank you very much. My name is Hawa Sinare. I am here under the Africa Legal Support Facility, which is an institution of ADB. I am based in Dar es Salaam, but I come from a very small village in Kilimanjaro where I've seen the rural electrification taking place in grid, but also the increase of the demand and the supply is affected because, of course, you get a lot of people needing electricity and the supply that is available is not there. But I've seen also the role that off-grid solar is doing. The demand in my village is more than what is available. And it shows that if our governments give support to the private sector that is in our countries, that is providing off-grid solar for rural electrification, that could be a very good source for domestic electric need in our countries. And my question to my own Prime Minister is, I am happy that there's a review and there's an invitation to private sector and to other actors to come to Tanzania and to play a role in this field. What strategy do we have in the government is having to promote this type of off-grid solar supply in our rural areas? Because for me, I think it is both very quick and clean. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we'll get that question answered by the Prime Minister. And unfortunately, we'll have to wrap it up because the excellencies have other engagements. So the last word from you, Prime Minister, and then we'll wrap it up. Strategies on off-grid.
First, I'm happy to hear that my sister is here with us in this meeting. And I would like to give her comfortable answer that the government now in Tanzania is working hard to provide electricity to our rural areas. As I said, all those opportunities we have, solar is one aspect of the opportunity that we have. We have an institution called Rural Electrification Authority, which is dealing, is working hard, including provide grid to the villages, as she said. Second one, now he's working hard to provide solar services. It's a fund taken by the government purposely to provide electricity through solar resources, as a resource. Now we are installing solar to all primary schools, and we have 16,000 primary schools all over the country. We are providing solar electricity to all dispensaries. Our policy says that we have to, we should have a dispensary in every village. We have more than 3,000 villages in Tanzania, but now we are going. We are not reached far, but at least we went more than 50%, and we are trying to open up how to give this opportunity. So our strategy: one, to go through our national budget, to provide our national budget to that area. That's why we formed Rural Electrification Authority, which is dealing with the provision of energy to our rural areas through solar. Second one, through solar, we invite all, if we get another someone or company to invest in Tanzania through solar, if you are capable enough, you are invited, the door are open. With this meeting, first I want to thank very much the president of ADB. President of ADB is providing financial support to the companies which invest in Tanzania in energy. So thank you very much for your doing. And I think you will continue supporting Tanzania through your bank. Mm-hmm. And all investors who are also intend to invest in Tanzania. So we are still continuing providing electricity through solar. We have this wind speed, we have the geothermal. And my friend over there said that we have to concentrate in renewable energy because it's cheap, we understand. And we are still implementing also. Our intention in Tanzania government to reach to the rural river areas by 2025, by 90%. Now we think we'll reach there because many investors show the intention to come to Tanzania and we are still discussing. That's why I used this meeting to invite you all over the continent, the Africa, outside the Africa, to come and to Tanzania to invest in energy. Our intention is to protect also our forests because most of the forest is completed by our people by taking charcoal, and that's why my friend over there said that we have to put more emphasis on climate change. We have to protect this opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we'll have to leave it here. I would have loved to have continued the discussion, but as I said, the excellencies have other engagements. The Prime Minister of Tanzania, Vice President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and the President of Chad, President of the Republic of Zambia, and the Prime Minister of Mozambique. A round of applause to all our panelists. Thank you very much.